I'm upset. 50,000 on my head is disrespect.
Good day, everybody. Welcome back to Interviews with Anna, and I am here today with a professional basketball player by the name of Jaraun Kino Burrows.
Hi, I'm Jaraun Kino Burrows, 12-year European professional player, captain of the Bahamas senior national men's basketball team.
Okay, so let's start off. How did you get into the sport basketball?
Actually, my first sports growing up was baseball and track and field. I went to Xavier's and then went to St. Augustine's until grade 9. Over that summer, I had a big 5-inch growth spurt, and my parents felt like it would be better to go to the States with my auntie and uncle in Nashville and start to play basketball.
So from Nashville on, that's when you developed great basketball skills?
Yeah, I would say when I started in the States and went on to college.
And what school did you attend while you were in Nashville?
I left after SAC. I went to a school called Good Pasture Christian School in Nashville, and then I changed schools, went to another school to graduate called Metro Christian. And from there, I did 2 years at junior college at Volunteer State Community College. And then after that, I transferred Division I at Indiana University, Fort Wayne.
Can you tell me about your experience in Nashville?
It was great. It was a big learning curve coming from the small islands, moving to Nashville. Completely different culture, school system was different than I was used to. And like anywhere, moving to a new country, you got to learn the ins and outs. But, I just worked hard and day by day, kept trying to accomplish my goals.
So can you tell me about how did you balance, just move to Nashville, how did you balance just starting to, get into basketball and do your schoolwork at the same time?
The thing about being a student athlete is you really have to be a student first. That's most important. You ain't making the grades and so what? You can't play on the court. So for me, and school didn't come easy for me. So when I had to work really hard in the classroom, and then Once I was maintaining grades, and that was always the thing for me, just keeping my grades up. I always loved to play. So once I maintained my grades, the basketball stuff kind of came easy because I was always a hard worker. And from there, I just continued to pursue college because I was a student athlete first.
So when do you say was the point where you knew this is what you want to do for real life? Is this something you want to pursue?
I never really had a big NBA dreams because I grew up here. I wasn't really a big NBA fan when I was young. I was more so in the track and field. I really wanted to run in the Olympics. But once I moved away and I saw what basketball could do for me, and I really fell in love with the game. And once you fall in love with something, it ain't really like a joy. It was a hobby that I could. Once I found out it was a hobby that I could turn into a job, I just was full force. My workouts and with everything else to accomplish my goals.
So for students, I know discipline plays a huge role in being an athlete. Can you tell me what are some obstacles that you had to practice that discipline in while your journey of being?
Definitely. Discipline is to make it. You have to be different, And I look at the Buddy Heels and DeAndre's. These guys, they sacrifice parts of their childhood, me included. They sacrifice a lot of time when other kids was going out and doing a lot of stuff. We would sit back and we'd be in the gym late night and also early morning. So I would say the number one thing you gotta do is sacrifice. You can't follow the crowd. You gotta figure out what you want and go after it.
Okay, and you are currently in
I'm currently playing in the top French division in the south of France in a town called Marseille.
So how was France being?
Well, Europe in general, I've played, this will be my 12th season. I played in six different countries. I started in Sweden, then I moved to Slovakia, went to Switzerland, went to Finland, went back to Sweden, went to Israel, and then the last three seasons I ended up in France. So I like traveling. I like new cultures. And I feel just blessed that basketball has given me the opportunity to travel the world and to come home and bring some of the things that I see other countries doing with their youth and their development to bring that home. I just try to, you know, I've been blessed, and I just feel like I could, it's a lot that I can give back.
And so, I'm pretty sure based on travel, you met a lot of people, you encountered a lot of experience. Did you probably pick up any languages? Did you learn French or
anything? Throughout the years, especially when I was younger, I used to learn a lot of the languages and the countries that I played in. But, you know, it's like trying to learn two languages, then three languages, then it all starts to run together. So now that I am living in France, I can understand a lot, and I have enough French to move around my day-to-day life, but I'm not fluent. And the team offers a class, and maybe this year, I'll take that class.
So let's talk about basketball. So what is your position on court?
I play more power forward center.
And were you always a power forward center?
I was always an inside player. Later on in my career, I worked on my outside game. I became more versatile. That helps me against bigger, stronger, big men. I could bring them outside and play them quicker.
And what would you say is who you looked up to in basketball?
Oh, well, coming up from here, I was, I remember the Bahama Games, watching the Freeport, Lutra, and Nassau teams. That was when I first actually really had basketball heroes. Dexter Cambridge and Scott Forbes and Quinn Hall, Ricardo Pia. A lot of these guys, the local guys, was my heroes growing up, because that's all I was able to watch.
Okay, so I want to brainstorm something. So, off the spot, if you had a chance to create a shoe, a basketball shoe, what would the name of that shoe be?
My shoe would be called The Sacrifice.
And why?
Because that's all my life has ever been. You know, I leave my home and my family for 10 months a year, just to come back home for 6 weeks or for 8 weeks a year. And I've been doing this now for 12 years. And, you know, I do this because to live my dreams and for the best opportunities for me and my family. You know, I have to move away to play the game. We don't have a pro league in the Bahamas like a lot of these other countries do, so we can't play at home. We have to travel abroad, and I would say that's the biggest, that's why I would name my shoe The Sacrifice. That's all my life has been, I feel like.
So do you ever think that, maybe not soon, but will you ever come back to your side?
Oh, definitely. I planned my life to come home. I started a basketball youth program this year that's doing really well. Trying to take some kids who are having troubles going to U.S. and Canada with the visa rules and stuff with hardship and stuff like that. I'm trying to take some and put those kids in academies in Europe. I had a lot of success last year with one kid from Anatole named Dominic Bridgewater. He had troubles getting abroad, and basically it was nothing else for him, so I took him with me to Europe, and he signed a professional contract within 5 months. Which was a really big deal, because it shows the just the natural raw talent that we have as Bahamians, and what I want to show them is that you know, there's opportunity, not only, you know, in the States or in Canada, but in other parts of the world if we just feed into it, and hopefully we can keep helping more boys get off, because that's what it's about.
Okay, so hypothetically speaking, I am a basketball, let's say I'm a teen who's just coming up. Just going into basketball, I probably am a troublesome person who doesn't know how to find a balance with causing problems and basketball. What advice would you give to me?
You know, like I try to tell most kids, I run into a lot of these kids on a daily basis, even very talented. It's just, you have to, even some from the tough surroundings and situations that they're in, it's just negative. So you have to be self-motivated, self-driven. I didn't have a guy like me, you know, when I was coming out. So I had to learn all the hard ways to do stuff. You know, guys, we coming back home now. We starting programs with the Federation. I have all my young boys in the gym, 8 o'clock to 10 p.m. every night. And, you know, we trying to change the culture in the Bahamas. We trying to bring it to, like, where I've seen in other countries where professional players and old pros and the current top players, they all come together and they play with the youth and they grow the youth together, playing good basketball and as a family. So I just think, you know, some things about the culture here, once it changes, and we mix the development stuff in with all this raw talent we have here, the Bahamas is a problem for years to come on the basketball scene.
Yes. So before I conclude this interview, any last word that you would like to say for the viewers who are watching this?
Definitely, you know, and especially to any kids that are interested in, you know, playing college or professional basketball, you know, like I said, you have to be self-motivated. You know, nobody's going to get out there and tell you every day to do your push-ups or your sit-ups or go run the beach. You know, I wake up at 6 a.m. still now, and I have contracts, and, you know, I also, what I like to talk about is taking advantage of opportunities. You know, I see a lot of coaches here bringing these clinics and, you know, a lot of people trying to help. So every time you get an opportunity, you know, treat that like that's gold. Like, you know, that can get me out of here, that can give me an education, that can help me feed my family. And you know, you can come home and you can go off and come home in the summers and live good and give back. And that's what it's about. So that's what I would tell kids. Just continue to you know, be thorough and chase your dreams. Don't let nobody tell you can't do it.
Well said, Mr. Burrows. Thank you so much for this interview, guys.
It's great. Please, thanks for having me.
Please, please tune in to Interviews with Anna and stay tuned for my next interview, guys.
Hi, this is Jaraun Kino Burrows, and you are watching Interviews with Anna. Stay tuned for the next episode.
Yeah.
I'm working on dying.
I'm upset. 50,000 on my head is disrespect. So offended that I had to double check. I'ma always take the money over. That's why they need me out the way, what you expect. Got a lot of blood and it's cold. They keep trying to get me for my soul. Thankful for the women that I know.